way, Benjamin Zander went on to have us sing Joyful, Joyful. He went on to have us sing it several times. And each time, when it was over, he would say, and invite us to live more fully into what we were singing. It feels like this is what Jesus is doing when he comes to see these men fishing. Yeah, you could keep on fishing. You could keep on doing this work that you were raised to do, that you will probably die doing. It's what your people do. Or you could come follow me. Now we look at this text sometimes and we go, what? They were willing to just drop what they were doing? Leave what they've known all their lives? Leave their family? Just go? And that was it? Of course it wasn't it. They followed Jesus, yes. But they struggled. If you pay attention to the text, whether you're reading Mark, you're reading Matthew, or Luke, or John, you know they struggled, just as you and I struggle, to be reminded of what it is we're called to do. We each have different gifts, you know that, right? I was chatting with someone this morning before worship, and she reminded me of a comment I had made some time ago about, I don't do parties. You know that about me, right? I can work the room if I've got a job to do, but I don't do parties, at least I don't do them very well. And so other people do the parties, right? I don't answer the door when it's dark out. Me, the one who's willing to go march around the block, I don't answer the door if it's dark out and I'm not expecting someone. Each of us have gifts that we nurture. And sometimes we're tossed in the middle of something that isn't really our gift, but somehow we got talked into saying yes. And in the middle, we go, what am I doing here? And if we're gracious with ourselves, if we're willing to listen to God, if we're willing to listen to the people who know us and love us, we probably realize it's time to make a change, right? So we can do the thing that we're called to do. I know I've told you this before, but I get to tell you again, because I'm standing here and I've got the mic. It took me a long, long, long time to be willing to hear that God was calling me to this work. A long time. It took me such a long time that I was 43 when I started seminary. And because I was doing the work I thought God had called me to, which was working with organizations to make them stronger, it took me 9 years to get through seminary. I was in no hurry. I was already doing the work. And then I graduated and struggled with the ordination paper. It's the silliest stuff. The United Church of Christ has before us. We're going to be ordained. Write it down! And every time I started, I was talking about parish ministry. Phyllis, why wasn't I doing that? I wasn't going to do this work. They kill you in this work. No way! I was going to do what I was going to do. And I was working on Jim's laptop, and I'd see what I was written, what I had written, select all, delete, delete, So that went on for, a year after I graduated. Yeah. A little sick. Finally, I don't know exactly what happened. Maybe because I was willing to talk with folks about what was happening for me. People who knew me, people who had walked with me, people who loved me. And they essentially said, get it together, girl. You see what you're called to. And so, 18 years ago, I started doing this work. And I loved it. When you find what's right for you, you love it. That doesn't mean it's always easy. That doesn't mean it's not without frustration. But you know, because you're connected to it. You know you're doing the thing you've been called to do. Jesus walked along the shore. And he said, Simon, Andrew, come follow me. I know you're good fishers. Come follow me. Now, this text today starts out with after John was arrested. What had John been doing? John had been baptizing people in the Jordan River. Now, that was an honorable thing to do. And John kept saying, if we get enough people baptized, then the realm of God will be here. And Jesus shows up, and he says, whoa, wait a minute. Like it or not, like what you see around you or not, like what's going on in the world or not, the realm of God is here now. And we are called to connect with that world. Like the 300,000 people who marched yesterday in Chicago alone. Like the people who marched worldwide. We will not be silent. We will not let those that are in power decide our fate. It might be awful out there, but we're going out there. You're going out there? I'm going out there. Every day we go out there and we make choices. We make choices about doing stuff the way we've always done it. And taking for granted the person in front of us. Or we can stop for a moment and say, Jane, how's it going? And Jane will respond to us. We can check with the person who's fixing our coffee. How's your day going? You know, they're well trained and they always ask you. And how often is it that I just go right into my order? So today I think it'll be a tall mocha note. Or can I just stop for a moment and say, my day's really good, how's yours? Just connect. It's a little thing. It's a huge thing. When we work and live in the world and just bump into each other and knock each other out of place and maybe say, oh, excuse me, we are buying into what the powers that be want us to buy into. Jesus does not want us to do that. You know, it used to be that I could say, you know, we've got it pretty good, and most of us do. So it might be hard for us to imagine what first century Palestine was like. The world has changed so much that all of us have some sense of first century Palestine, and some of us have a deep understanding of first century Palestine. We started this service with joyful, joyful, because for me, it's a message of possibility. This text today is the heart of the Gospel of Mark, and it reminds us that Jesus came here to tell us, to show us, that it doesn't matter what else is going on, the realm of God is here. We have to be willing to see it. We have to be willing to be laughed at, because people around us see something different. Right? Is it okay to be laughed at? It's got to be okay to be laughed at. Is it okay to be frustrated and worried and discouraged? Of course, you're a human being. But remember, there are other people in this space, and there are a whole lot of people who aren't in this space who believe like you do, that we can make a difference, that we will make a difference, that we do make a difference. I know that some of you have struggled with depression at times in your life, and some of you are probably struggling with depression right now. And you know what difference it makes to reach out to someone and just say, talk to me. Or you know what difference it makes when someone says, so how's it going today? And they actually want to hear your answer. It's not just a social gesture. You know. I saw a TED talk probably in the middle of the night sometime about some research about what it is that helps people live long lives, long, vibrant lives. And it actually didn't have to do with whether you were skinny or fat. It didn't have to do whether you were rich or poor. It didn't have to do with whether you exercised, whether you smoked, whether you did any of these things. I mean, you know, obviously they'll have an impact. But you know what the top two things were? The two most important things for living a long, prosperous life in terms of engagement with the world? It is whether you have a small group of people who have your back, your go-to people, the people you know you can rely on. And when you don't have the capacity to reach out, they reach out to you. That's the second from the top. And the top is, it's actually saying hello to the barista. Seriously, it's getting involved with other people, even if it's just a hello to a stranger. It's that connection. Faith is in there too, but it's not the top two. Now, those of us who keep saying, you know, I could do well to drop a few pounds here, or I could do well to put a few pounds on, or I'd be better off if I did more walking. Yeah, true, that's true. But the things to concentrate on are that small group of people you can trust and rely on, who can trust and rely on you, and your willingness to engage the world even in simple ways. Now, what was Jesus doing? Come on! Follow me! Be this tight group that argues with each other all the time and doesn't ever get my message. Come on! Talk to each other, engage with each other, and engage with the rest of the world. I'm pretty sure Jesus did not see that research. It's quite new research. It was a Jesus talk, not a TED talk. What we need to remember, when the world is falling down around us and falling apart, is that Jesus has called us to stand up when we can, to show up when we're willing, and to speak up when others don't have a voice. We can do that. I know we can do that. We've been doing it. Pilgrim will continue to do it. This afternoon at 2:30, I hope you'll be here, because the wider community is coming here to celebrate this journey we've been on with us. We're going to hear some stories, and we're going to enjoy some delightful food in the parlor. After that, we start in the sanctuary. The intention of this time together is so that the wider community can say to Pilgrim, you know we've got your back, and we will continue to have your back. And so that Pilgrim can say to the wider community, we've been out there for a long time, and we're staying out there. We're staying with you. We're walking with you. We're marching with you. We're singing with you. We're working with you. The work continues, even when things change. The work continues. Jesus said, follow me. And I know that you do, and you will.